أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين، ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين خاتم النبيين سيدنا وسيد الأولين والآخرين بالقاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتخبين المنتجبين المظلومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
My bad, my respected brothers and sisters, my elders and learned scholars. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. كل عام وأنتم بخير. خوشالي مبارك. On the auspicious occasion of ميلاد الإمام جعفر الصادق عليه السلام الله. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bestow us His ziyarah in the dunya, His wisdom in our life affairs, and His shafa'ah in the akhirah. Ilahi al-haqi, ameen. Just two requests. First of all, we will address the subject of la'na, inshallah. Everything we will be saying today, inshallah, will be in the compass of the knowledge and wisdom and the ahkam which the Imam alayhi salam Allah has presented to us, inshallah. But my second request is actually a personal one. If I could ask the mu'mineen, the Imam alayhi salam Allah says the dua of a mu'min for a mu'min, and inshallah we're all mu'mineen, is mustajab. So if I ask all the mu'mineen to keep me, inshallah, in your dua, some personal issues going on, and I hope with your dua they will be resolved. Ilaha al-haqqa, inshallah. As for the Imam alayhi salam Allah, before we go into the subject of la'n, we want to first give a backdrop to this Imam. His birth coincides with the birth of Khatam al-Nabiyyin, al-Habib al-Mustafa, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa
sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
But more than this shared date, the Imam alayhi salam Allah shares many qualities with his grandfather Rasulullah. First and foremost of them is the distinguished merit which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has singled him out for, in that Allah has called him As-Sadiq. And the Holy Prophet was always recognized as As-Sadiqul Ameen. And we find from all the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah, the one who is primarily distinguished with this merit is none other than the Imam alayhi salam Allah, the sixth Imam. Now, does that mean that the other Imams are not Sadiq? Hasha lillah. Does that mean that the other Imams are not Shaheed? When we say Imam al-Husayn is Shaheed Karbala, no. Does it mean that Imam al-Sajjad alayhi salam Allah is called Zainul Abidin wa Sayyid al-Sajidin? Does that mean that his ibadah is better than Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam Allah? Absolutely not. Because we find in the books of tariqh that Imam al-Sajjad alayhi salam Allah, when he would finish Salatul Layl, his salah would be so long that when he finished, he would collapse and he would pass out unconscious. And whenever he regained reconsciousness, he would weep and he would say, As-salamu alayka ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, who can do one of your sajdas? So the Imam who is known as Sayyidu Sajideen wa Zainul Abideen is talking to Imam Ali. He says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, who is capable of doing one of your sajdas? And this is an Imam who is distinguished as Zainul Abideen wa Sayyidu Sajideen. The reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has distinguished the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah with certain qualities is not that they have qualities which the previous Imam or the forthcoming Imam are lacking. Na'udhu billah. They are all from the same cloth. But the idea here is, as Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam Allah sets out the beautiful example, someone came to the Imam and he said, Oh Imam, why is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave different anbiya, different miracles? As in, if they are all occupied by the same office and they are employed by the same employer, who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they have all been sent with the same mission, which is to invite people to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then why is it that their miracles are different? So the Imam alayhi salam Allah beautifully responds. He says, O servant of Allah, let it be known that the variance in the miracles and the distinguished merits of the prophets is not conditional on the anbiya of Allah, rather it is the condition on the people of the time. He said, what do you mean? The Imam alayhi salam Allah says, as for the time of Nabiullah Musa, Nabiullah Musa, his community had reached the height of magic. So if Nabiullah Musa alayhi salam Allah came to them with the Quran, while the people did not speak Arabic, nor did they care for the mastery of the Arabic language, the miracle of Nabi Musa would have been wasted on these people because they would have not recognized it as a mu'jiza. So therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had to make Nabi Musa come with a miracle that the people could understand that this is not achievable at the time of the people. So the magicians, when they threw down their staffs, and the staff, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and the magicians caused an illusion on the eyes of the beholders, making them see that the staff was actually moving. Walaykum salam wa rahmatullah. When Nabiullah Musa threw down the staff, the magicians had the science to know whether this was magic or not. So therefore the magicians were the first to recognize that it is a miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and immediately they said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Amanna bi Rabbi Haruna wa Musa. We believe in the Lord of Aaron and the Lord of Musa. As for Nabiullah Isa alayhi salam Allah, when he came to the people had excelled in medicinal science. The Roman Empire, given that it was constantly in times of war, there were many injuries and many different illnesses that would come from war, and it was one of the first human societies that had to address illnesses which were not only current in its own environment, given that they're always at war in Africa and Asia, and then they went to Europe. It meant that this community came across illnesses all over the world. So therefore they had to find medicinal sciences for all different types of illnesses. But there were three types of illnesses or three types of human ailments that they could not find medicine for, and they were actually researching at the time how to heal the lame, the leper and the blind, and also was there a way to bring the dead back to life. And these things they could not do. So therefore if Nabiullah Isa ibn Maryam came and he threw his staff and it turned into a serpent, they would say, oh, it's a magic trick, it's amusement, it's entertainment, maybe we can use it in the gladiator rings. But they would have not perceived it to be a miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, Nabiullah Isa alayhi salam Allah had to come with a science that the people understood its nuances, its intrinsic details, and they would be able to recognize immediately that this is a miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, he came with the science of healing. When Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam came to the people of Arabia, whether he healed the blind, the lame and the leper, the people would have not understood him as a prophet. Or whether he would have cast a stick that became a serpent, they wouldn't have seen him as a prophet, because they excelled in the mastery of the Arabic language. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran al-Kareem, when there are the ahruf al-mutaqatta'a, where Allah says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alif lam mim, ha mim, noon, wow. These are just Arabic letters where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the tafsir of these Arabic letters is that Allah is challenging the Arab people. He says, you know, you are the masters of this language. This Quran is made from these letters, alif lam mim, kaf ha ya ain sad. If you say that you can make a Quran like the Prophet using these letters, Bismillah, tafadlalu. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And if you are in doubt of what we have revealed to our messenger, then bring forth one ayah that is like it. And if you are unable to, and you shall never be able to, then be mindful of the hellfire which is being prepared for the staunch disbelievers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is saying to the people, could Allah have used the same argument against the Arabs if it was magic? No, because they're not masters in magic. Could Allah have used the same argument that come forth with a similar example if they were masters in science and astronomy? No, because they're not. But they were masters in the Arabic language. And therefore this leads us to the idea that when we say Al-Hadi Al-Mahdi, Ajalallah Ta'ala Faraj Al-Sharif, when the Imam comes to the people, he's not going to fight them. You know, some people say that Imam will go back to the old ways of fighting, and the old ways of fighting is what? You fight ignorance with knowledge. When the Imam comes forward, we have knowledge that says, and the Imam will stand between Maqam Ibrahim and the Kaaba, and he will call out to his followers, and they will reach him in a blink of an eye. Some of them will travel through the clouds, and some of them will cause the earth to come closer. You know, today people turn around and say, it will be by means of miracle. And the answer is not necessarily. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Nabiullah Sulaiman, Nabiullah Sulaiman looks at his congregation and says, who will bring me the throne of Bilqis, Queen Sheba, from Yemen to my palace in Palestine? Before she enters, at that moment Bilqis had just knocked on the door. Nabiullah Sulaiman says, before she enters this door, who will bring me her throne? Her throne is equivalent to Bab Khaybar, that it needed 22 people just to lift it, 44 hands just to lift it. So Nabiullah Sulaiman, who has all the power of Nubuwwah, could have brought the throne himself. But what here Allah is trying to show, that a Nabi or a Wasi of a Nabi is supposed to empower us through knowledge and wisdom. He's not going to do all the work himself, he is there to empower people. This is a very important, we'll come to, about Imam Ja'far Sadiq alayhi salam. Here, Nabiullah Sulaiman says, who will bring me her throne? Allah says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَقَالَ عِفْرِيتٌ مِنَ الْجِنِ. Ifrit from the jinn means said the most powerful of the jinn. Because, you know, insan normally believes, oh, if I can speak to the jinn, I will have supernatural powers. This is actually madalla. This is humiliation for the insan. Because Allah has given us the aql, which is greater than anything. And here Allah wants to show the power of person who has faith in Allah, as opposed to the powers of the jinn. وَقَالَ عِفْرِيتٌ مِنَ الْجِنِ, said the most powerful of the jinn, that I will bring you her throne before you stand up to say salam to her. You know, when someone walks in, you stand up to greet them. Before you stand up, I will bring you her throne. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about an individual who is the mu'min known as Asi bin Barziya, where he says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَقَالَ الَّذِي عِنْدَهُ عِلْمٌ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ, said the one who had not superpowers, not ruhani powers, not magical powers, but said the one who had knowledge from the book. It's all about ilm. وَقَالَ الَّذِي عِنْدَهُ عِلْمٌ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ, said the one, a human being like you and I, but he was a mu'min, said the one who had knowledge, a portion, ilmun min al-kitab means a part of the knowledge, not the entire knowledge. Amir al-Mu'mineen says that this individual only knew one letter from the book. Said the one who had knowledge from the book, I shall bring it to you before your eye opens after you blink. قَبْلَ أَنْ يَرْتَدَّ إِلَيْكَ طَرَفٍ. Which means what? In a twinkling of an eye, he was able to bring the throne from Yemen to Palestine, before Sulaiman alayhi salam Allah could even blink, and it was there in a twinkling of an eye. And this woman, who was the queen of half of the world, when she saw this miracle, she said, you know, I'm not going to fight with you, because my people can benefit from this knowledge. Amanna billah, we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the Hujjaj Allah ta'ala farajahu sharif, when he comes to us, he's not going to talk to us about, you know, stuff which are irrelevant. He's going to show us scientific knowledge. Maybe he will show us how we can get to Mars with knowledge. Maybe he will cure cancer and AIDS and poverty, yarhamukumullah. But the Imam will come to us with ilm, because every Imam before him came with ilm. The Ahlul Bayt all follow one sunnah, sunnah to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Rasulullah was not a butcher, he was not barbaric, he wasn't evil. As a matter of fact, when you look at history, Rasulullah's risala was 23 years. Of that 10 years, there were battles. In those 10 years of battles, history has only recorded the number of people who died in the battles led by Rasulullah or defended by Rasulullah. In all those battles, both from the believers' armies and from the enemies of Rasulullah, there is only 1,014 victims who have died. Only. You're talking about 10 years of battles and only 1,014 people die. You look at Hiroshima in a twinkling of an eye, how many millions were killed? You look at the war in Iraq where today Wadi Salam, which is the oldest cemetery in the world that is still used since 2003 to today, has expanded by 40%. Do you know what that means? That means from the days of Adam alayhi salam Allah to this day, from 2003 to 2016, mankind has killed so many people that the graveyard expanded by 40%. And then you turn around and you say Rasulullah led wars. Yes, he led wars in defense, but even in wars there was rahmah. Not everyone would die in those wars, only the staunch leaders in the wars, and they would be called to a one-to-one fight. So when we look here, the Prophet wasn't a barbaric person. When Imam Mahdi comes, he's not going to lead a war against people, he will lead a war against ignorance. He will lead a war in science, in technological advancement. You know, that's why we have this hadith by Imam Ja'far as-Sadiq alayhi salam that the Imam will place his hand on the head of mankind all, and he will allow us to use 100% of our mental capability, whereas today Einstein to this day has been recorded as only being using 10% of his brain, and he became Einstein. So imagine what we will become if we have 100%. وَقَالَ الَّذِي عِنْدَهُ عِلْمٌ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ, said the one who was acquainted with one letter of the book. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, وَنَحْنُ الْكِتَابِ, we the Ahlul Bayt are that book. We have all the knowledge. So imagine what we can have of powers and special. So here we come back to the point that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the malaika, when the anbiya were given certain mu'jiza, it wasn't a limitation on the Nabi, because limitation on the Nabi means limitation on Allah. Because the Nabi, everything he has is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the limitation is not on Allah and not on the Anbiya. Rather, the limitation was on the people of the time. They thought in a certain way. They had certain social values. Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, in his time, Shahada was required. And therefore, he is known as a Shaheed. In the time of Amir al-Mu'mineen, many people claimed to be Amir al-Mu'mineen. Yes, we had three people who claimed to be the Umara, the leaders of the believers. But Amir al-Mu'mineen was given the title as Amir al-Mu'mineen because he is the true Amir. One incident where Rasulullah was sitting with his companions, he said, call to me, atuni bi Amir al-Nahl. Call, bring to me the master of the bees, the prince of the bees. They said, Ya Rasulullah, we don't know what's the prince of the bees. He said, Ya'sub ad-Din. They said, we don't know who is the master of the bees, the wasps. He said, bring me Amir al-Mu'mineen. They said, Waman huwa Amir al-Mu'mineen? He said, bring me Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. Here they said, Ya Rasulullah, why did you call Ali ibn Abi Talib Amir al-Nahl? Why did you call him the master of the bees? Rasulullah said, because the bee is the most dignified of Allah's creatures. It only eats that which is pure, and whatever it digests from it comes out as pure honey. You never see bees in the trash can. You see them on flowers, yes? They are too dignified. So they only eat the pure. And when they digest that pureness, they give us honey, which is the sweetest natural thing known to mankind. Rasulullah says, likewise, Ali ibn Abi Talib never goes to makruh. He only goes to the most beautiful things in religion of Allah. And when he leaves examples, he only leaves the best of examples for mankind, which are sweet as honey. Therefore, in the world of faith, Ali is Amir al-Nahl. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So these qualities given to the Ahlul Bayt are given for a purpose. Let us come to why this Imam of many reasons is known as Sadiqul Qawli wal Fi'l. Honest in all his actions and in all his sayings. When Bani Umayya la'natullah alayhim ajma'in wanted to be rid of the Ahlul Bayt, they thought that by killing the Ahlul Bayt, they will make them forgotten. But Sayyidat Zainab alayhi salam Allah in Darbari Sham, in the court of Yazid al-La'in, she said to Yazid, O Yazid, exhaust whatever avenue is available to you and explore whatever means are ready for you. But by Allah, you will not eradicate our remembrance, nor will you make our dhikr forgotten, ever. And to this day we find, where are the graves of the enemies of the Ahlul Bayt? And look at the graves of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn and Sayyidah Zainab, where people are willing to die to defend them. No financial reward is given to them. They leave their children, their family, their jobs, their homes, and they go out to defend the shrines of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah. There's a beautiful poem written by a Sunni scholar from Bilad al-Sham. He was actually the leading scholar in Sham when he came to Najaf for a interfaith dialogue, and he saw the grave of Amir al-Mu'mineen, the shrine of Amir al-Mu'mineen. He returns, this poem is actually written on the inside of Imam Ali's dome, where he returns to the grave of Muawiyah and he says, Aba Yazid, rise, O father of Yazid, and take a look at your grave. Most certainly your eyes would weep in sorrow. Your grave has become the mating ground for cats and dogs and the toilet for flies and other insects. You fought Ali ibn Abi Talib for the dunya and you won, but Ali fought you for the akhirah and Ali won. Journey to the land of Najaf and see the bones of Ali. If the people did not fear Allah, they would worship him. That's how much love and mawadda has been given to Amir al-Mu'mineen. Al-Shafi'i, who is the most renowned of the four schools of thoughts in the Ahlus Sunnah, as being the master of Arabic language and a student of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, all four of them are students of the Imam. He has a beautiful saying written on his grave, which says, if loving Ali ibn Abi Talib makes me a Rafidi, then call me the master of the Rawafidah. And he's a Sunni. So here the Ahlul Bayt were all given distinct titles because of the circumstances that were there. Bani Umayya had a plan and an agenda: be rid of the Ahlul Bayt and secure power for us by killing the Ahlul Bayt. That failed after Karbala. They realized that if you kill the Ahlul Bayt, there is so much love for the people in their hearts that you cause a revolution. Bani Abbas la'natullah alayhim utilized this opportunity of love for the people, for the Ahlul Bayt, or love of the people for the Ahlul Bayt. And they began to call out, Ya li tharat al-Husayn, let us avenge the blood of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam Allah. And they led a campaign against Bani Umayya and they killed Bani Umayya and they became the Khalifas. But Bani Abbas were even more tyrants than Bani Umayya and more cruel to Ahlul Bayt than Bani Umayya. Al-Ma'mun wanted to do something to make the people forget the Ahlul Bayt. But he knew that killing them is not possible. So what did he do? He said the Ahlul Bayt are renowned for their knowledge. So what we will do is I will translate the philosophies of the Greeks, wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah, the Greeks and the Persians and the Indians, and I will bring all the knowledge of the world and make it in Baghdad in a place called Baytul Hikmah, the house of wisdom, or Darul Hikmah. And here I will show the people that you don't need the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah, because there's other sciences in the world. You know, today our youth are sometimes led to believe, unfortunately by certain, you know, scholars in the Shia world, Habibi, you don't need to worry about the Ahlul Bayt. Today is the day of science. Go, you know, let's go to Harvard and Yale. You know, going to Hausa is a waste of time. Reading about Imam Ja'far is a waste of time. Being in the majlis of the Ahlul Bayt is a waste of time. There's more knowledge, more beneficial knowledge out there. Absolutely not. This was the argument of Bani Abbas, la'natullah alayhi. So the idea was what? That we can find knowledge other than the knowledge of the Ahlul Bayt. So they produced their Darul Hikmah, But Imam Ja'far Sadiq alayhi salam Allah established in Hawza in Medina, Madrasat al-Madina al-Munawwara, where between history recourse to this day, there were between 4,000 to 12,000 students. 4,000 of them became renowned scholars across the world. There is a book called The Great Muslim Scientist and Scholar, which I recommend everyone to look for, Al-Imam Ja'far Sadiq alayhi salam Allah, written by French scholars, not by Muslims, written by French scholars during the age of the Renaissance, where they say that all sciences today, from physics, from chemistry, from astronomy, from biology, from linguistics, all this knowledge goes back to one man in history, Imam Ja'far Sadiq alayhi salam Allah. He's the one who taught us the basics of all these knowledges. And yet you find today Muslims who fail to recognize this, but the one who is atheist recognizes. But the only flaw in this thesis that is presented by these groups, it was actually in a convention of scholars in the West, because they are atheists, they did not believe or accept the idea that the Imam was divinely appointed. So therefore they came up with the argument that the Imam alayhi salam Allah is actually someone who traveled the world or became acquainted with scholars of different sciences and he learned from them, but he excelled, which we obviously can prove, and in this book it's also proven the reasons why this is a fallacy. Because number one, the scholars would go to Baghdad, not to Medina. The scholars who Bani Abbas was paying them their weight in gold would go to Baghdad, not to Medina, number one. Number two, if there were people acquainting themselves with Imam Ja'far Sadiq, there was no financial reward. But there was punishment from Bani Abbas. So which scholar would travel from Iran and India and Greece to go to Medina so that they can teach Imam al-Baqir for nothing in return? Already that journey itself in those times requires financial aid. And then at the same time, what is it, the reason that makes them want to go to the Imam? How did they come to know about the Imam that they should, you know, educate him? And at the same time, risk their lives and the lives of their family members being persecuted by Bani Abbas? Absolute fallacy, number one. Number two, the books which apparently were used to educate the Imam were destroyed in the library 200 years before Imam was even born. So how did these books come to the Imam? So there's many fallacies in this theory. We as Shia believe that the Imam has what is known as ilmul ladunni, which is that divine knowledge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which science today actually proves and scientists are trying to reach, that the human genes record everything that happens. Cockroaches are similar. Cockroaches is very hard to kill because they learn from their ancestors the genetic coding, but they have direct access to those genetic codings. Insan has a what we call a veil between the conscience and the subconscious. When we're awake, the conscience part of our brain works. When we sleep, the conscience goes to sleep and the subconscious starts to work. A person who has ilmul ladunni, there is no veil between the conscience and the subconscious. And when we say the Imam will take us to that level of knowledge, we mean that the Imam will remove this veil where we have access to the conscience as well as the subconscious, the ilmul ladunni. So we believe that the Imam, by divine power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invested in him, had this as power of ilmul ladunni. And that the Imam alayhi salam Allah was not in need of teachers. He is the ustad. He is the muallim. He is the teacher. Our brothers and sisters in the school of the Ahlus Sunnah say there are four Imams that they follow. Hanafis, Shafi'is, Malikis and Hanbalis. All four of them were students of the Imam. But obviously their agenda was to produce students to compete with the Imam. And these were the four that were used to compete with the Imam, with the exception of Malik. Malik actually became recognized as an Imam after he died, right? So when we look at this, we find that the Imam alayhi salam Allah, in a world where many people were telling lies about Allah, many new ideas were coming into Islam about how to perceive Allah, right? The Imam alayhi salam Allah was recognized by people that whatever he said was the truth. So he was known as Sadiqul Qawli wal Fi'al. Sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa
Allahumma.
Let us come to a subject pertaining to the Imam, so we can tie it in with the request about the subject of La'an. When you read Usul al-Kafi, Bihar al-Anwar, and the other books of the Al-Shia about the life of this particular Imam, it is recognized and it is written that the Imam alayhi salam Allah said, in every salah I curse 5 men and 4 women. And we won't go into the names, but suffice it to say that these are the 5 men who laid the establishment of dhulm against Ahlul Bayt, as we say in Ziyarat Ashura, Ashura, where we say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَلَعَنَ اللَّهُ أُمَّةً أَسَّسَتْ أَسَاسَ الظُّلْمِ وَالْجَوْرِ عَلَيْكُمْ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَبَنَتْ عَلَيْهِ بُنْيَانًا. May Allah send His curse or remove His mercy from a nation which laid the foundation for your oppression, O the Ahlul Bayt, and upon your oppression built their empires. وَبَنَتْ عَلَيْهِ بُنْيَانًا أَبْرَأُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَإِلَيْكُمْ مِنْهُمْ. I seek disassociation from them, and I attach myself to Allah and to you by disassociating from them. The Imam alayhi salam Allah cursed 5 men, and these would be the first 5 khalifas, with the exception of Amir al-Mu'mineen obviously, and 4 women. We know 2 of them are related to the Prophet, and the other 2, one being Marwan ibn al-Hakam alayhi lanatullah's wife, and there is another woman, but we don't want to go into the actual names. So the question is, did the Imam alayhi salam Allah commit a sin, na'udhu billah, by saying la'na on someone? Because you know, today we have this argument, la'na is like haram. People say it's haram. So do we have a ground to send la'na on people? Is it recommended? Is it mustahab? Is it wajib? Is it makruh? We will look at it from the Quran Kareem, sallallahu alayhi Muhammadin wa alayhi wa sallam. Before we go into the Quran, we first ask ourselves a simple question. What is the best action we can do? It is an action which was done not only by Rasulullah, but an action which is done by Allah Himself, yes? If Allah does something, then it is the best of things to do, yes or no?
Yes.
Absolutely. So, does Allah pray 5 times a day? Astaghfirullah. If we say Allah prays 5 times a day, then who is He praying to? Does Allah fast? Na'udhu billah. Because if we say Allah fasts, then we say He needs food, and Allah, no, ghani, He's self-sufficient from everything. Does Allah go to Hajj? No. So then what is it that Allah does which we can do? A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir la'in rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna Allaha wa malaikatahu يصلون على النبي أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل.
Allah says inna, and inna is in Arabic grammatics means an emphasis on something, which when we translate in English it means most certainly or indeed. Indeed, Allah and the angels, this is not the act of humans, this is divine act, and it is the act of the angels. Indeed, Allah and His angels send salutations upon the Prophet. Now the address comes to who? To everyone? Did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, Ya Bani Adam, sallu alayhi wa sallamu taslima? No. Did He say, Ya Insan, sallu alayhi wa sallam? No. Did He say, Ya ayyuha alladhina hadu sallu alayhi? No. The address is to people who believe. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. Oh, you people who have iman, who have belief, then you too should send salawat ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
So the idea is that this is an action of Allah and the angels. Now, is there anything else that Allah and the angels do? Yes. Let's take a look at the Qur'an al-Kareem, Surah al-Baqarah, ayah number 159. For those who wish to make a reference, it's chapter 2, ayah number 159. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الذين يكتمون ما أنزلنا من البينات والهدى من بعد ما بيناه للناس في الكتاب أولئك يلعنهم الله ويلعنهم اللاعن. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. most certainly, again, we find inna. Indeed, those individuals who do what? Who conceal the truth of the signs which we had sent to mankind and made them manifest in the book. Such individuals, Allah sends la'na on them, and let all mankind send la'na on them. Okay? Al-la'inun. Whoever is capable of sending la'na, let them send a la'na on them. Dushmani al-bayt la'nat. The other ayah of the Quran al-Kareem, and we'll come back to the tafsir of these two ayats, is again, chapter number 2, ayah 161, Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, innal ladhina kafaru wa matu wa hum kafirun, ulaika alayhum la'natullah wal malaika wal nasi ajma'in. Salla ala Muhammadin wa ala.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali.
Those individuals who disbelieved after believing in the truth. And here obviously, if we go into deep tafsir, it is after they refuted the bay'ah of Ali ibn Abi Talib, because on Yawm al-Ghadir they gave bay'ah and then they left that bay'ah. Those individuals who disbelieved after they have witnessed the truth and they died still on disbelief, on such individuals Allah curses them, the angels curse them, and let all mankind disassociate from them. وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ. You see, salawat, Allah invites the mu'mineen. Here, Allah invites mankind. Which means what? This is not subjective. La'na on the enemies of the Ahlul Bayt is not subjective, because all mankind has suffered because of them. Today, whether you are a Muslim or not Muslim, because of ISIS, we all suffer. Muslims suffer because we have had a negative image, and the non-Muslim suffers because he will be killed by ISIS. So that consequence of the disassociation, these people who abandoned the wilayah of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah after they have come to believe in them, that is something which affected everyone. But salawat is beneficial to the mu'min, because you need to have recognition of the imam of your time, and then you send salawat, salawat ala Muhammadin wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
So when we send la'na on the enemies of the Ahlul Bayt, it's not just the sunnah of Rasulullah, it's not just the sunnah of the imams, it's the sunnah of Allah himself and mankind, and it is the natural disposition of mankind. وَيَلْعَنُهُمُ النَّاسُ أَجْمَعِينَ. Everyone in mankind has this capability to distinguish between right and wrong. We know that lying is wrong, so we disassociate from liars. We know that stealing is wrong. We don't need a Quran to tell us that stealing is wrong. Likewise, we know if you kill Ahlul Bayt in Nubuwwah, then la'na is incumbent upon you. One of the first people to die in defense of Imam Hussein after Waqi'at Karbala was a Christian priest in the court of Yazid al-La'in, when he saw that Yazid la'natullah alayhi was striking the face of Abu Abdullah with the stick. What did he say? May Allah curse a nation that kills the grandson of its prophet. Yazid la'natullah alayhi says to him what? He says, oh man, you are lucky that you belong to the Christian faith. If you had been a Muslim, I would have the authority to torture and kill you. You know what the Christian man responded? To defend the truth and die defending the truth, I have to be a Muslim. To defend this Hussein al-Shaheed, I have to be a Muslim. And to attain the merit of dying for defending him, I have to be a Muslim. He said, yes. He said, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّكَ يَا يَزِيدُ مَلْعُونَ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. I testify that there is no God but Allah. And I testify that Muhammad, the grandfather of this Hussein, is the messenger of Allah. And I testify that you, O Yazid, are cursed in this life and in the hereafter. And this man was decapitated by Yazid la'natullah alayhi. But it shows you that when Haq shows itself and Batil shows itself, you don't need to be a Muslim or a Christian or a Jew to recognize. But this Christian was so taken by the level of injustice being done that he wanted to prevent the injustice, but he was told, you can't do anything about it unless you're a Muslim. He said, you know what? I will change my religion to defend the Ahlul Bayt. So it shows you that this concept of giving la'na is fitrah. to disassociate from evil, to oppose evil is fitrah. It doesn't have to be between a Muslim and a non-Muslim. The other thing that the Imam alayhi salam Allah did for us, is which is also joined with Rasulullah, we said that they are both joined in the sense that they are born on the same day. They both have the quality of being called As-Sadiq al-Amin. But even more importantly, the role which they rendered to society is the educators of mankind. Nabiullah Ibrahim alayhi salam Allah, in the Quran al-Kareem, Allah tells us that after Nabiullah Ibrahim built upon the foundation of the Kaaba, he made a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rabbana, our Lord, and send amongst these people Rasulan minhum yatlu alayhim ayatik wa yuzakkihim wa yu'allimuhum al-kitaba wal-hikma. Our Lord, send to the people of this nation a prophet from amongst them who will teach them your verses and purify them and educate them about your book. O Allah, indeed you are Azizun Hakim. In Surah Al-Jum'ah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani al-la'in ar-rajim, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. About Rasulullah, Yusabbihu lillahi ma fi samawati wa ma fi al-ard al-malik al-quddus al-aziz al-hakim. Allah praises himself first for what he is about to tell us. He says, you have to know that this message is not coming from an ordinary person. You know, sometimes you read an article about medicine, you say, what's the qualification of this doctor who wrote this? Is it someone who just graduated last year, or is it someone who's a leader in the field? I need to know, what is the qualities of this person? What is the qualification of this person? So Allah is about to reveal something to us. And he says, what is about to be revealed is not by an ordinary individual. It is someone who يُسَبِّحُ لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. He is glorified by whatever is in the heavens and in the earth, and he is Azizun Hakim. He is too dignified to give us something that is not good. He is Aziz, he is dignified, and he is Hakim, he is wise. What is this thing that Allah praises himself for? Huwa alladhi, it is he, Allah. Huwa alladhi ba'atha fil ummiyina rasulan minhu. يَتْلُوْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. It is he who sent amongst the people who Allah calls Ummiyin here. It means from Ummul Qura. Ummul Qura is Mecca. In the same way that if you're from New York, we say New Yorkers. If you're from Florida, we say you're Floridian. If you're from London, we say you're Londoner. If you're from Arizona, we say
Arizona.
Thank you very much. If you are from Mecca, which is known as Ummul Qura in the Quran al-Kareem, people would say Ummi, which doesn't mean illiterate. When Allah says in the Quran al-Kareem, Al-Rasul al-Ummi, the Prophet who is Ummi, doesn't mean that Rasulullah couldn't read and write. It means the Prophet who is from Ummul Qura, the Makki person. And Imam alayhi salam Allah responds to that, where he says Makki, talking about Rasulullah. And then he says Ummi, from Mecca and from Ummul Qura. Now here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it is Allah who sent to the people of Mecca a prophet from amongst themselves who recites the ayat to them and purifies their souls and teaches them the kitab and the hikmah. What, for what reason? وَإِن كَانُوا مِن قَبْلِ لَفِي ظَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. For surely before this prophet came to them, they were the most ignorant of people. يَوْمِ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ or أَيَّامِ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. In the same way, the Muslims after Rasulullah became a community of Jahiliyyah because it became a community of constant fighting. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam Allah came to them and established the madrasa and educated them on the sciences of the world. So he raised them into the golden ages, and that is the meaning of the ayah, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, after in Surah Al-Jum'ah, وَآخَرِينَ مِنْهُمْ لَمَّا يَلْحَقُوا بِهِمْ وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. This prophet was sent to educate mankind, and there are others that will come after him who will also do the same thing. Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah, more specifically Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam Allah sallu ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali.
So in the same way that the Muslim world has become known as Muhammadis because they follow Rasulullah, those who abandoned the Ahlul Bayt and fell into Jahiliyyah as a direct consequence of disassociating from the Ahlul Bayt. There was another group that kept to the Ahlul Bayt, and that group is called Ja'fariyyah. So we have Rasulullah, and the people take him as an identity, and the true people who kept to Rasulullah have taken another identity, Ja'fariyyah, as a recognition of this Imam alayhi salamullah who educated us, purified us, taught us beautiful sciences. And again, I strongly recommend this book, the great Muslim scientist and philosopher Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salamullah. You can find it on PDF, you can just save it in your phone right now, you'll find it in PDF format online. It is a very beautiful book, the great Muslim scientist and philosopher Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salamullah. It is written by French thinkers, translated I believe in Pakistan or in Toronto by a Pakistani Sayyid. But its origin was written in French, then translated into Farsi, then translated into another language, then translated into English. But this book is the collective work of non-Muslims, non-muwahideen, atheists who don't believe in Allah, but they praise the Imam for all the sciences, which today we take for granted, by the way. So this Imam alayhi salamullah is nur in the dunya for the believers, and nur in the akhirah for the believers that we will attain his shafa'a ilaha al-haqq. Ameen. Sallu ala Muhammadin wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala.
We raise our hands in dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this yawm al-fadil, this generous day where there is an imam who is Bab al-Hawa'ij. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our first dua is, oh Allah, bestow upon us a day and a time in which we see a beautiful dome and minarets over the grave of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq and the A'imah of Jannatul Baqi' ilahi al-Haqq. Ilahi, bestow us with their ziyarah in the dunya and their shafa'ah in the akhirah. Ilahi, convey our salams to his grandson Sahib al-Asr al-Amr. Tell him that the only sorrow on this joyous day is that he is absent from our eyes. May we be able to see him inshallah in the dunya, and may we be able to serve him in his absence so that we can also serve him in his presence. Ilahi al-haqq. Ameen. Allahumma arif baynana wa bayna bihaqq Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. O Allah, make us of those who are in the dua of Imam al-Zaman in his salah when he is in qunut. Make us of those people that the Imam prays for specifically bihaqq Muhammadin wa ali bayti al-tahiri. Our students, O Allah, by the haqq of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, give them the ilm of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq so that they can excel and be a source of pride for the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah. Our elders, forgive them. Our marhumeen, do not hold any sin against them. Our sisters, preserve their hijab by the hijab of Zainab al-Kubra alayhi salam Allah. The faqir amongst us, enrich them so that they have no reason to be distracted from the love of the Ahlul Bayt. The mariqh, give them shafa'ah so that their illness do not prevent them from attending majalis Ahlul Bayt. And our marhumeen and the marhumeen of sa'ir al-mu'mineen wal-mu'minat, la siyama man mata ala hubbi Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad, and especially those who have made this majalis possible of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam Allah. Oh Allah, forgive them all their sins and give them the gift from us of Surah Al-Mubarakatul Fatiha with the loudest of our salawats ala Muhammadin wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
توجه زيارة
Before we begin with the ziyarah, could we ask a special Surah Mubarak al-Fatiha for Al-Hajj Fatima, Sulaiman Shams, and Al-Hajj Hussain? Is it Hussain or Hassan? Hassan. Ismail Shams. Inshallah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept this Fatiha from us for them and make it a nur in their grave. Inshallah, Surah Al-Mubarak al-Fatiha. We invite the arwah of our marhumin to attend with us as we send our salutations to the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam Allah. Assalamu alayka ya Rasulullah, assalamu alayka ya Habib Allah. السلام عليك يا خاتم النبيين، السلام عليك يا سيد المرسلين، السلام عليك وعلى أهل بيتك الطيبين الطاهرين، السلام على خديجة الكبرى أم المؤمنين، السلام على فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين، السلام على علي المرتضى أمير المؤمنين ويعسوب الدين وقائد القر المحجلين، السلام على الحسن والحسين سيدي شباب أهل الجنة إمامان قاما أو قادا، السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك، عليكم مني جميعا سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. Everyone together. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته، بالخصوص سيدنا ومولانا أبي الفضل العباس وزينب الكبرى وسكينة الصغرى. السلام عليكم جميعا يا شهداء كربلاء وسبايا كربلاء ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام على أئمة المسلمين وحجج الله على العالمين من ذرية الحسين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن العسكري والحجة الخلف القائم المهدي، عجل الله تعالى فرجه وسهل الله تعالى مخرجه وظهوره ورحمة الله وبركاته. اللهم اجعلنا من الداعين إلى سبيله والذابين عنه والمستشهدين بين يديه بحق محمد وآل بيته الطاهرين، وصل اللهم على محمد وآل بيته الأبرار.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل بيته.